greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
There are no two words in the English language more harmful than good job.
Welcome to the Make Remake Literary License Podcast episode with Keith Shago and co-hosts Vicky Ray and Steve Templeman, discussing the original film and the remake, looking at what was improved upon, where they went wrong, and whether anything lives up to the original. Don't forget to have your say by commenting or sharing links, or just follow us below. Now on with the show!
What we've got here is failure to communicate.
You know how we used to look up in the sky and wonder at our place in the stars? Now we just look down and worry about our place in the dirt.
Hate is baggage. Life's too short to be pissed off all the time. It's just not worth it.
Life.
See, in this world, there's two kinds of people, my friend. Those with loaded guns, and those who dig. You dig.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
Hello, welcome to the Literary License Podcast. It is Make Remake Day, where we'll be discussing two films, the original and the remake. And we'll be discussing the Cage Aux Folles from 1978 and the Birdcage from 1996. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us. We got Joe Rendazzo with us. Hello, Joe.
Hey, everyone.
And Vicky Ray.
Hi, everybody.
And I'm your host, Keith Shago. Before we get started, let's find out what we've been up to, starting with you, Joe.
Really just watching a lot of movies lately. My regular job's been insane because we're just so short staffed, and sadly this latest shooting was just 2 miles from me, so that's, I think, kind of affected things and affected the mood at work. But other than that, just watching a lot of movies. I've gotten into watching a lot of old crime thrillers from the 40s and 50s again. I don't know why, but I've just been kind of drawn to watching a lot of those and watching the stuff that I'm doing for here.
Well, it's something different, and it's, anything's better than turning on regular cable. I've been watching a lot of old stuff too, but you know, it's really kind of refreshing actually, and it takes your mind off stuff, and it's fun and it's good
sometimes
stuff.
It really is. Like I just get into it, and then I'm just like, for like weeks on end, I'm just watching like old noirs and old crime movies and just digging those. I'm trying this year to watch at least one movie a day that I have not seen before.
That's a good idea. Yeah.
Trying to do it because I'm trying not to fall into watching
the same genre
things I've been watching forever. So I'm trying to one movie that I've never seen before every single day. Obviously, some days it's impossible,
right.
But I'm trying to do it as much as I can.
Yeah.
One of the old James Cagneys are starting to make appearances on Amazon Prime.
I noticed that. Well. There's a lot of old stuff, like Turner Classic Movies. They're class. I'm starting to get scared because Turner Classic Movies is putting on stuff that came out when we were like kids.
Yeah, like
and
War
now
Games.
It's a classic movie. Like War
Games
y'all.
And Matthew Broderick. But,
well, I mean, it's the idea of an instant classic, you know, like something could be a classic immediately. It's so fucking good that yeah.
True, like yeah, that's true. You're right. That does make sense.
But what about yourself? What have you been up to?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Well, since the last time, well, I finished the last. I was really bummed. The Boys only had 8 episodes, and I finished it last night. And I'm just totally upset that it's over. And I really think they set up for another year. For next year, because
isn't
I don't.
This season over? I haven't seen it.
There's
yet.
Too many loose ends, and I was like, the more that show goes on, the more violent, vulgar, nasty, and offensive. And I love that shit, especially on that show. because they can get away with it. And they do it in a way that they're making fun of everybody, you know? So, I mean, nobody is left unscathed when it comes to the show. But yeah, I don't know whoever, I'm not going to ruin it for anybody, but it's really worth catching up on if you haven't, because lots of surprises in the last few episodes. But
I only saw the first episode of the season so far. I was waiting for them to get a little further down.
Oh God, wait till you get into it. Oh my God, it's so good. Yeah. I can't sing its praises enough. And then I finished watching Stranger Things, and I was really bummed when that came to an end. You know, just like all these, I mean, it takes a lot for me to really love a series where I want to like binge, you know, like Vampire Diaries. I think I was like, had the flu one year and I binged all 8 seasons for 4 days or something like that. But that, it's got to be one of the best. I mean, if you're into that kind of thing, you know,
there's a lot coming out on Netflix.
Dystopian supervillain.
But there's a lot coming out on Netflix. I mean, Resident Evil is coming out.
Yeah, I'm waiting for them to put all of it on there. You know, they haven't done
the set. The Sad Man is coming out. That'll be out in the next 4 or 5 weeks. Neil Gaiman's.
Yeah. Oh, I can't wait to see that.
Elvis super superhero. That's coming out.
Elvis superhero.
Yeah.
Like Elvis as a superhero?
Yeah. Where he's not dead.
I was talking to you about it yesterday. I can't remember or not. But I was like kind of freaked out because people were talking about Elvis the King. Elvis, he was great, Mr. Gospel singer. And then it's just like, yeah, Elvis, who bought his wife when she was 14 from her parents. Then I was talking to my mom, but he didn't touch her until she was his age. I go, come on, Mom. I go, do you really believe that?
It's like, well, no, it probably is true because he met her in Germany. And then
they got married.
They didn't get married until he got out of the army about 2 years after he got out of the army, and then she came over, so she probably would have been an age, because that was like 4 years, so she probably would have been about 18.
I didn't realize. I thought she was like 16 or 17. I didn't know she was 14.
No, she was 18. No, Jerry
Lee
Lewis.
It was a different world back then. Yeah, Jerry Lee Lewis, you know?
Yeah, he married his 13-year-old cousin.
That's the thing. We can't really condemn them based on our morals now when 50 years ago.
Oh, I think our morals are completely gone down the shitter compared to then. So, you know, I mean, I don't know why people are so freaked out about it.
But you got to remember that some states it was legal to marry a 13-year-old as well, like in Arkansas and places like that.
In Arkansas, that's are you?
I'm not kidding. That law, but no, I'm not. It's God.
I'm kidding.
That law didn't change until the 80s.
Yeah.
In a lot of places like that. Like, well,
I think you still can with peer. I think you got to, I don't know if it's 15 or 16, but I think you got to have parental something or other.
And you also got to remember that the life expectancy at that time, I mean, you weren't expected to live past 70. So that makes a difference as well. And,
yeah, I guess longevity has kicked in. And I just thought it was interesting because
in most communities, people quit school by the age of 13.
Yeah. I think my grandfather, by the time he got over here, when he immigrated here from Italy, he only had a second grade education, you know, but then that was
my
like
father
19,
had a fourth
20.
Grade education.
Huh?
Yeah. My father had a fourth grade education because they had to pull him out of school to work. Yeah.
That's what they did back then. That's what they did.
You're 10 years old. You're able bodied. Get to work.
Yeah.
That's what they used to do. So like we can judge all we want, but you know, Charlie Chaplin married a 14-year-old too. So
I think that was generally the thing back then, because really there was a lot of it going on. But I just happened to notice everybody was downing Elvis in this article. It was a Facebook forum, so it doesn't really matter considering the source. But it kind of made me wonder, because I honestly didn't know she was 14. And it was just an interesting conversation that they had.
Well, they met when she was 14. He was in the army with her father, so this doesn't mean anything was going on at that point. So that's what I'm saying. There's a difference between dating someone.
She was definitely his thunderbolt. There's no doubt about that. But it was one of those forums where they were showing what Michael Jackson's kids looked like now, what Elvis's granddaughter looks like now. And there's just all kinds of weird ass discussion going on in that. But other than that, I haven't really got to the movies. We're just getting ready to go to upstate New York and see the fam, but trying to stay cool, keep my garden alive in oppressive heat. What about you over there in the pond?
Yeah, just work. More work. Getting this writing stuff done. Doing this producing thing with this writer is causing me a pain in the ass. But besides that, yeah, same old, same old. Nothing
same
exciting.
Old, same old. Anything exciting going on in the disease era over there?
COVID's going to be, it's going to hit again. It's going to be worse than the first wave. So we're getting ready.
What kind of COVID? I mean, not that we just don't have to learn to live with it, but you figure the strains would be getting lesser as far as
they're never gonna get lesser. They just can keep changing. They've been like flu strains. There's always gonna get stronger, but and there's four strains on its way, so.
Right.
But it is what it is, so.
Yeah, I guess we just can't stick our head in the sand and not live.
Yeah, if Putin sticks by his allegations that he's going to enter Alaska, it won't matter anyway.
Yeah.
Because that'll be the end.
I think I'm going to get back off the wagon and enjoy my life for the next few
Precisely.
Weeks.
Precisely. If he goes into Alaska, you might want to go and have that holiday.
It's like, fuck it. It's all fucking gone if he goes after Alaska. But then again, you know, we need a wartime leader. So we're screwed either way.
Well, the thing is, the problem with Europe and with America and England is that war used to get you out of a depression but nowadays, because none of us produce anything, you know, America doesn't produce anything and we don't produce anything.
Not anymore, like, not for the last 19 months.
Well, you didn't produce anything before that anyway. Your production companies are all gone to, like, you know, China and Mexico,
India,
and so forth, and India. So basically, if the world goes to war, the only countries you're going to get rich are going to be India and China. That's where everything's being made.
So. Oh, yeah. China will be doing fine. Taiwan, maybe not so much.
So that's the reason why it's like, you know, like the Gulf War and all the other stuff that's going on. That's
those were big money makers back in the day, no doubt.
Well, they weren't big money makers because before
they worked for the war machine. Not for us.
No, it wasn't a moneymaker for America because they thought
for the companies that produce the weapons. They're the ones.
Yeah, but the companies that produce the weapons are not American companies. That's what I'm saying.
That's what I'm saying. They made money.
They're not produced in America because before, like World War II, that's what got everyone out of the Depression the first time.
It put everyone
to work basically because everyone had to go. You know, you had all the women
for the boys away,
and children, and. So
the war in Iraq basically crippled us financially.
Yeah, because
we should have never been there.
Well, you had to buy all your weapons and you had to buy all your bullets and everything from a third world country. So, you know, that's the reason why. If you don't no longer, you know, if you're producing them back home, then chances are you probably would have made money and that would have kept the economy going.
Right. And that's we just got to sit back, strap in, and wait to see what's going to happen.
Because in the old days, war used to get you out of your economic depression. If you won, that is. If you lost, then it would put you deeper. But if you won, then it would take you out of it. But now that
we need to take all the world leaders, put silver collars on their neck, and drop them off on an island, Keith.
That's a royale.
And just let them decimate each other. There we go. Problem solved. World peace.
And on that note, before we get started, we want to give a shout out to Rina Sawayama, whose new album will be out on the 2nd September. And thank you for dedicating the song this week for us. The same like she did last week. And she's releasing this song.
Beautiful voice.
Yeah, she is a BAFTA winner. She is a Mercury Prize winner and a Brit Award winner. And her new album will be out on the 2nd of November. And we want to thank you for the song Chosen Family. So there. Take it. So we'll have that at the end of the credits. Thank you, Rena. If you'd like any more information about Rena's new album, you can go onto our website. And in the next newsletter, we will be giving 6 albums away of her new album. So that brings us to La Cage Aux Folles. The Cage Aux Folles, or in English, is called The Cage of Mad Women, or what's often released as Birds of a Feather, is a 1978 comedy film directed by Edouard Molinaro, based on Jean Perrault's 1973 play of the same name. It stars Hugo Tognazzi, and Michael Serrault. As a gay couple operating a drag nightclub in a French resort town, Remy Laurent as the former son, and Michael Gerbrew and Carmen Spirata as new fiancés, ultra-conservative parents. The French language picture was a Franco-Italian co-production by United Artists. This is the first film adaptation of Perrault's play, which would later be adapted into the 1996 American film, The Birdcage. The film was released in Italy on October 20th, 1978, and in France on October 25th. It was a considerable commercial success, becoming one of the highest grossing foreign language films released in the United States of all time. It won the Golden Globe Award for Best Foreign Language Film and was nominated for 3 Oscars, including Best Director, Best Adapted Screenplay, and Best Costume Design. Michael Serrault won the Caesar Award for Best Actor. It was followed by 2 sequels with Tignazzi, Serrault, and Joe Gerbro reprising their roles. So what we're going to do is cut to the trailer of La Cage aux Folles. We'll be right back.
At La Cage aux Folles, the outrageous is commonplace, and nothing is ever what it seems. At La Cage aux Folles, one man's comedy is another man's tragedy, and the answer to the question of sex is the riddle of love. At La Cage aux Folles, illusions are born, and illusions are shattered, all in the name of romance. At La Cage aux Folles. Cage aux
Folles. Hello, welcome back to the Legalizing Podcast. We're discussing La Cage aux Folles. So, Joe, what are your thoughts on La Cage aux Folles?
I did not expect, I mean, I obviously knowing that The Birdcage was a remake and having seen that first, I didn't realize it was going to be this similar.
Yeah, it was very much that. So.
This was, seeing it earlier this week was the first time that I had seen it. I loved it, went and bought the Criterion Collection version of it and actually read the liner notes this
morning.
What's
the difference?
Criterion Collection. I bought the cleaner
version, widescreen.
Yeah, okay. It just looks really fantastic. I mean, I haven't popped it in yet. I just got it. So, but that's how much I really enjoyed this one. It's interesting in that the only thing I guess I could focus on is the differences between them, which are very slight, but the main one that I kind of noticed is the ending. This one has more of an ending that's kind of downbeat and exposing the right wing zealot of the moral guy.
The moral, what do you call that? What was it called? The moral that what was that called?
The moral majority.
No, it was like the Ministry of Morality, basically.
Yeah, in the French version, yeah. The moral majority is what we called Falwell and those assholes over here.
Right.
But yeah, it's strange seeing that ending because, like, at the end of The Birdcage, it's, hey, everybody, we can all learn to get along. On this one, it's, no, we're going to expose this guy. And we're going to make him, you know, we're going to completely destroy his career. That's the big difference that I noticed. I mean, there were slight ones along the way,
but not many. Didn't you think the script was pretty comparable?
The screenplay here was great. I absolutely loved it. Yeah, they were very, very similar. We'll get to a lot of the other stuff with why the other version's different. Right. Because I think a lot.
I like picking your brain though before I forget, because I always learn something from you before I drop the I thought.
Feel like the other version was different because maybe they did a lot of ad-libbing. We'll get to that, I guess, when we get to the second movie. But the performances here, I thought, were really, really good. What were the other? I'm trying to think what the other differences were. I watched them back to back on the same day.
I find this one a lot more natural. It doesn't feel like they're acting.
Oh, yeah.
I also think it's quite interesting about this film because, you know, and when this came out in 1978, we did have this gay undercurrent that was starting to go mainstream anyway in America with the Village People and disco. And,
right.
And of course, AIDS would shove all that back into the closet again.
Right.
But you have to remember that in France, things were a lot different in Europe because France is a lot more progressive than America as far as this, as far as homosexuality goes or sex and stuff like this. I mean, if you look at Dark Noon, which is basically Highsmith's Talented Mr. Ripley.
They weren't allowed to get married in Europe, were they back then? Or what? Because I know they were partners in the French version. And I know that gay marriage wasn't recognized over here until recently. So was it recognized in 78? Because it was pretty groundbreaking.
Gay marriage in Europe didn't happen until about 8 years ago.
Because I was going to say, it's pretty groundbreaking.
Gay marriage here is different than gay marriage in America, though. There's a big difference.
Big difference.
Gay marriage in America, only gay Americans can marry other gay Americans. If you're found marrying someone who's not an American, they will send them back. And that's under Obama law. And they have
really,
yeah.
He had a lot of weird deportation laws.
Well, it's kind of this odd thing that basically they had to give somebody something. They also let me give you everything. So it's not really this.
You know, somebody comes up to you with a green card and you can marry them. They can't get away with it really as much anymore. But you couldn't do that if you were gay. Is that what you're saying?
If I met someone that's not doesn't have a UK passport and doesn't have a visa, we can get married and then he can apply like a normal married couple or like a normal couple and apply
for
the visa and stuff like this and be considered a real relationship. In America, because your states are not all aligned and it's not federal law, it's only state laws, so therefore immigration is not recognized.
Well, the thing I liked about it, about both, I can't really say it without saying one about the other. I really like how it showed the humanizing, you know, gay people and the regular people with senses of humor, feelings, you know, they love, they're capable of great things and taking care of each other and their families, and they love their boy. But the one thing I had, the same problem I had with both these, with all this love and comedy and all this, it's such a feel-good movie, it's not even funny. Is the kid, the boy that plays the son, both of them, French and in the westernized version, is a little shit for dissing his parents. And I felt like, I mean, I felt so bad for Albin and for Albert because this kid is a little tick turd. I mean, come on. You know, I would never send my mom out of the house, basically his mom. You know, and
yeah, but I think that's more of a comedy plot because you get that.
Yeah, I know, but it's still
a comedy plot that basically it's just like, you know, this has been going on since screwball comedies of the
30s. Right. You know,
like
Mom,
Pa Kettle sort of thing is that you have the older son, right. And then basically he meets the girl and he wants to bring them home to Mom, Pa Kettle, and they have to pretend that they're suburban. You know, that, you know, this is kind of a device.
I know, but I felt so bad for the other character, for Alvin. I mean, it kind of broke my heart because I can't imagine my son, Mom, please leave the house. You're embarrassing. And I don't want you to meet your new daughter. So I guess I was projecting when I was watching it.
Well, it wasn't the new daughter-in-law.
It was the parents.
It would be her parents, which in the remake, Robin Williams straight up says, and he's right, it's not that, it's that her parents are assholes.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's really the crux of this is these people who can't accept people for who they are.
Right.
And I felt the same way about the son. I'm like, oh, come on, man. Like,
I don't know. I knew it was part of the, it had to have, you know, the catalyst for the comedy and everything had to, revolve around that. And now the situation evolved, but it just got me a little bit because the actor who portrayed in both instances, Albin and Albert, it just broke my heart a little bit because he did so good about being upset and sad. I mean, because you know, the guy really loves his son, you know, as a mom, you know, so.
Specifically the scene where Albin or Albert shows up in the suit and he'd already tried to walk like a man. He tried to butter his toast like a man.
I know.
Now he's trying to dress like a man. And it's, and you feel it. It's still not good enough.
Yeah, that's what it was. I mean, it bothered me. It really did. It bothered me a lot. And I didn't find that part of the movie funny. It really bothered me.
Well, I don't think that was meant to be funny. I think it was meant to be like, dude, feel how you want to feel about the lifestyle, but these are human beings. And that's what that scene cuts right to the core of, is you just hurt another human.
The character he's playing is a very loving, kind, somewhat eccentric individual. I think he played it great. I mean, I was laughing my ass off both versions.
But I also think that it works. I think it works out quite well with the son being the way he is, because at the end of it, you get that you have a character. Before, you would just have a son and basically you'd just be there. Now you have a character that grows by the end of the film, where he's accepting and he's like, okay, I'm in the wrong. Otherwise, he'd just be a shadow. He'd just be a shadow character. Wouldn't be anything. There'd be no growth or anything with him.
Well, could they have not dressed the father up a little better in drag? I mean, he was the ugliest drag queen I have ever seen, and I've seen a lot of drag queens.
Well, you also got to remember the age.
Yeah, he was old, yeah.
I mean, we're talking about a 50 to 60-year-old man at this time, and we're talking about a 50 to 60-year-old man in the 70s, which is totally different than a 50, 60-year-old man.
Just the 4 o'clock shadow, it always amazes me. I mean, I just amazed, especially, we used to, every once in a while, well, we haven't in a long time, go down to the drag shows in Dallas, because they are just so much fun.
Well, drag shows are a lot different now, because
I don't know how they do that. Their makeup is perfect. It is so annoying.
What's happening nowadays because of RuPaul's Drag Race and things like this is that now they're using corrective surgery. They're getting electrolysis on their face. They're taking female hormones now.
Yeah.
For their art of drag RuPaul's made things move further, but in another way, it's kind of moved things in a weird sideways direction.
His show's gotten a little funkier. I used to love his earlier series. I haven't really watched any of the new ones, but I like the beginning seasons.
Well, I mean, another thing is whenever you have a talent show that goes on for a number of years, whether it's X Factor, RuPaul, right, or Pop Idol, or so on and so forth.
It gets old.
America's Got Talent. Well, there's a format, isn't it? And then, you know, so when you're first going into it, you don't know what that format is. So everyone's going by the skin of their teeth. But then as the years go by, it's like everyone that's going into that show knows exactly what to expect. It's based on the play. It was a play.
That's right. It was a play first.
But it's a bit like going to Gordon Ramsay's Hell's Kitchen. You know, here we are, 12 seasons in, and it's like, and when they fuck up the scallops, you're like, what the hell are you doing? You should know how to make scallops.
I would never go on his show just because I'm all right as a cook, but I can't imagine being beat on so badly that I would probably be suicidal after I left his show.
The director, Edouard Molinaro and Francis Weber wrote the screenplay to this, so that's...
Excellent. It's just excellent, just all the way around.
Interestingly enough, this also became a musical as well.
I was watching bits and bits of that on YouTube yesterday.
I had tickets to see it with Kelsey Grammer, who I presume would have played the
Robin
conservative
Williams part,
I assume. And I didn't go. I had a visitor at my place. I gave my girlfriend the tickets, and she went with somebody. She told me it was fantastic.
I really wanted
to see that. What I was going to say is Edward Molinaro, I recognized the name because I'm like, I've seen something else by him. And it turns out I had seen the movie he made right before this, which was a movie called Dracula, Father and Son, with Christopher Lee playing Dracula. And
no kidding.
Yeah.
He's got a face on him. I thought I've seen him somewhere.
And basically what happens is Christopher Lee as Dracula and his son are escaping Eastern Europe, and their coffins are separated. Christopher Lee ends up in Dracula ends up in London. His son ends up in France, and it's a complete fish out of water story again.
How did this one get by me?
Because it's barely been released in the U.S. It finally came out on Blu-ray like last month. I had had a bootleg of it, and I had had a VHS tape of it like years ago, but it wasn't a very well-known movie. So it's interesting that he made another fish out of water story right before this, where in that movie you have a couple of vampires trying to fit into normal mainstream society. And in this, you go with the gay couple trying to fit in with very conservative people. You could say the bloodsuckers are on the other end in this case.
Right.
But it's, yeah, he made two movies that are kind of similar back to back. And when I realized Edward Molinaro, I'm like, well, let me rewatch Dracula and Son. And I realized kind of beat wise, it's very similar. You have a kid who's in France, and he's not really catching on because he's completely different from everyone else. So maybe wonder if this was kind of a theme with him. I also realized he made a movie called Oscar in the 1960s.
I know.
Well, you probably know the Sylvester Stallone one. Because they remade it apparently in 1990 with Sylvester Stallone.
I had no idea it was a remake.
Same here. I was just looking him up, and I'm like, hey, Oscar. And then I'm reading the plot line. I'm like, this sounds exactly like the movie where Sylvester Stallone made in like 1991. And it is apparently a remake of that movie.
Oh, so, wow. I didn't even know there was one before it.
I had no idea that, Eduardo Molinaro was, apparently such a trendsetter in a way, because a lot of his movies were remade, or at least two of them were remade in the 90s. I have to do a little deeper dive on him.
Right.
And of course, he got nominated for Best Director for this, which is...
He deserved it.
For foreign movies, you know, strange to hear. And I'm wondering if the Best Foreign Film Oscar didn't exist back then, because I noticed it didn't get nominated for Best Foreign Film.
This is 1978, right?
I don't know what year they brought that about, so I'm going to have to look that up. But yeah, this was I'm kind of starting to notice little themes with him. It's always that kind of fish out of water theme.
Now, the funny thing about this film, now this film is the gay community wants to cancel this film.
Why?
Because of the propitiation that gay people are limp-wristed.
Oh my God, really? I don't, that, I mean, okay. I mean, that was also a different world. There was also, I can't deal with the cancel. If I hear the word cancel, I'm just going to, my head is going to blow up. I don't give a shit. You cannot change everything constantly because of a small percentage of little bitches. And that's all this is. And I mean, it's perfect the way it is. Leave it alone. It's funny. There's a lot of things about women that get portrayed in movies I don't like or whatever, but why cancel it? They're already made.
Well,
they've already.
You know, I think my only problem with the cancellation thing in this is that, you know, I would find this more maybe a problem if I was out and gay in 1978, and this is what betrayed is what homosexuality is.
But didn't gays also work on this production?
No, but what I'm saying in 1978, I'm not saying I did have a problem, but I can understand having a problem in 1978, that because there's not a lot of gay cinema, and a lot of gay characters shown, and this is all that you would see, sure,
okay,
I can understand.
Gotcha.
Now we're living in a new millennium where you have shows where gay characters and every, you know, you have the whole spectrum now. So it's kind of like, so why are you getting offended by something that was made in 1978? Because, you know, it's come a long way as far as that, whether it's Will and Grace or Queer as Folk.
Well, historically speaking, that's what they should look at, is the evolution of it, you know, and how things have come out and how things are, you know, I mean, they're making movies, they're producing movies, they're starring in movies. I mean,
well,
you know, they've come a long way.
I think we can now say that, you know, like say the thing of drag, because of RuPaul's Drag Race, I think we can now assume that not all drag queens are the same either. You know what I mean? Because we've seen so many different.
But let's not forget, though, the funniest people in both of these movies are the character actors, actually.
Yeah.
You know? my Guatemalan-ness. Or whatever. What was it in La Cage aux Folles? What was it? Not Guatemalan. He was
He was Guatemalan, and in this one he was the original. He's a black gay man. And they that's another thing that the remake didn't really touch on, because you have that line of dialogue where, what was it? I've been called gay. I've been called black, but I've never been called something else. I don't remember what it was.
What was it?
I've been called gay. I've been called black, but I've never been called French.
Oh, that
line, there's no equivalent to that in the remake either. And that was a line that really struck me. Because I was like, wait a second. I think Hank Azaria played that part in the remake. And then when I watched the remake, I'm like, yeah, he did. So that there was that aspect of it.
I was literally on the floor every time he came on. Come on here, you are worried about my Guatemalan-ness. I couldn't stop laughing. It was so good.
Well, I also have to think that the black actor is playing the servant in this, or the butler, is a gay character. And this, and the thing is, when you see, if you look online and see interviews with him, he is that effeminate in real life.
But he's great, though. I mean, he's one of the best parts of the whole movie.
What I'm saying is, he's not a straight character, right, playing an effeminate character. He's an effeminate actor.
He's just effeminate
actor. So the thing is though, I do think that going back to like trying to cancel or trying to be upset by this, it's like you might want to look at the context, you know?
Yeah.
When we get to Birdcage, we got a straight male pretending that being in a really effeminate gay, and this is how we think effeminate gays are. Maybe that could be offensive.
Maybe.
But here, if you got, you know what I mean? I guess, you know.
But I doubt that the whole, I can't speak for gays.
I don't find any of it offensive.
I'm not gay, but I mean, it's such a heartwarming movie. I mean, I think that no matter who you are, white, black, whatever you believe in, whoever you vote for, there's always that one small percentage of that particular population that's going to piss and moan. And that's just no matter what, across the board.
There are a couple films that the homosexual population today have problems with.
Right.
They are.
Well, crazy. I knew they had a problem with Braveheart because of that one.
Braveheart has nothing to do with homosexuality. We're talking about homosexual films in general.
Just the films in general, okay.
And we're talking about Cruising with Al Pacino. There's still
I haven't seen it, so I don't know.
Boys in the Band, the original.
Liked that movie.
No, we're not talking about the Netflix remake. We're talking about the original 1970s.
I watched the original too. Was that offensive?
Well, it basically shows a lot of unhappy gays being very suicidal.
They were unhappy, you know.
But then again, as we were stating before, it's just like, you know, you have to look at things the way they are. And then at the time that this was made, and those films that when they were made, and though, you know, Cruising does have, they're a bit problematic and stuff like this. At that time, you're just lucky if you had a character that had gay characters in it at that time. Yeah. You were lucky at one point up until like the 90s. You were lucky if you saw a gay character in anything.
Are you talking about Europe and America, or more towards over here?
Of course, we had no gay characters in anything.
I always thought that they were more liberal and open-minded about sexual preferences over there.
Well, I mean, you know, there are a lot more gays, but I mean, it's very rare in between. Okay, you might get one a year maybe if you're lucky.
Right.
You know, it's not, you know, we're not talking about like, you know, it's, you know, having a gay character in a movie is probably as rare as having a all black cast.
Okay, gotcha. Okay.
You know what I mean? I mean, at one point, it's, you know, that's the way things were. So, right. You know, so I think that, you know, to get something like this made, and then the Birdcage in the 90s, which we'll cover, which is coming off the back of the AIDS crisis, which is quite amazing that it got made. Yeah. So, you know, and plus it didn't have any gay characters who were dying from AIDS, because there for a while, every character that had, who was gay in any character from 1983 to 1995, died from AIDS. They all died.
Which actually Tom Hanks just talked about how he wouldn't be able to play the character he played in Philadelphia nowadays.
I don't know.
But But actually, the way I feel about it, again, like Vicky, I'm straight, so I don't have so maybe it's not my place to say it.
Yeah,
but the way I feel about this movie is progress has always been slow, just in general in humanity. The fact that gay marriage wasn't like there were people like me in 2002, 2003 when I became an adult, going, well, why the hell not? Let gay people get married. Why do you give a shit what anybody else is doing?
Mm-hmm. They're not bothering anybody. You're not hurting anybody. That, they just want to live their lives like anybody else.
That's always been my thing. Why do you care if gay people can get married? And it's to me, the fact that it's legal now is great. The fact that it took so long to get there, I think is fucking ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But progress has always been slow in a movie like this. Okay, maybe the way Albin and then Albert were portrayed might be offensive and stereotypical. Yes. And maybe as a straight man, it's not my place to say it, but the way I see it is if it gets people who otherwise would be calling for their execution.
I thought it humanized them.
If it's taking people who would be otherwise calling for your execution,
right,
to look at these characters and go, you know what? They're people too. Then why the I don't know. To me,
I'm telling you, the one thing about these movies, I'm just so upset about how the boy treated Albin and Albert. I just cannot shake that. I don't know why it pissed me off and it stayed with me, because that character in both instances was played so well and so heartfelt that it was almost like a personal slight that he was so mean to him, and it just made me nuts. It just did. It made me nuts.
I mean, in a way, you know, continuing what Joe said, sort of thing, you know, the thing is, and I think this is what, this is what you have to remember as well. La Cage aux Folles was the highest grossing foreign film in America.
Yeah, true. Well, there's a big audience
here. And this film probably normalized, you know, homosexuality more than anything before it.
And to that, I said, good.
And you have to look at that, you know, sort of thing. Same thing like with the Village People appearing on Solid Gold singing YMCA did a hell of a lot, you know? Yeah. And that I think, you know, and it did bring out, I mean, I've said before, I mean, they were coming out of the closet. I mean, you know, things were progressing anyway. The AIDS epidemic that put everything back in the closet with Reaganomics and things like that. Reagan pretty much canceled a lot of stuff at that point because of the AIDS crisis. But this is quite interesting because this is everything was starting to flourish outwards. And homosexuality became quite a common thing. It wasn't quite hidden. Soap was around the same time. You had the gay character of Billy Crystal in Soap on TV. Right. And as you say, that this is all the part of the submergence, that if things didn't go the way they were, things probably would have been more progressive than
but the one thing, as in Soap, as it was in this movie, though, the ones, particularly one from France, because it was 1978, is that it humanized the gay population. And you did see they have feelings, they have relationships, they have businesses, they have families. And I mean, what they see probably, and I'm not gay, what they see is an affront. I see as some kind of, you know, is some kind of win, because people, I mean, a lot of people actually realize that gays are human beings. I hope that would bring that to
and this them. Is also a time where a lot of actors were like, you had Rock Hudson, who is rumored I mean, I don't know at this point if it's a rumor anymore, rumored to be gay but had to hide it. Victoria Price says Vincent Price was bisexual but really couldn't be out about it.
Right.
So to me, anything that normalizes humanity is a positive.
Yeah.
So
I think you also have to look at the gay community as a whole. And I think the same people that probably found a problem with this are the same people who I watched a documentary this week about gays who have a problem with Queer as Folk, the first series.
What is it? Queer as Folk.
The Showtime.
Right.
So that was the highest rated television series that people were watching in their homes, and it wasn't a gay audience. It was like a
regular Joe.
It was the spectrum. Guys, yeah. Because they had a problem with the promiscuous, you know, showing all gay people having sex all the time. Or and then you have but they also have a problem with the original L Word series as well. So I think that so when you hear these kind of things, I imagine it's probably those.
I used to watch that. I liked that show.
Yeah, which is always a small group anyway. But I'm just sitting there saying that I think, I to be honest, I think that no matter what you do or no matter what you have, there's always going to be a group people going to have a problem with everything.
Anyway. That's right. That's what I'm saying. There's a small percentage that are going to gripe no matter who we are.
I went through this year and I watched all the Charlie Chan movies, which of course, modern wise, you have in the case of all three series, you have a white man with, you know, basically yellow face, which, yes, it's offensive,
but
to today it shouldn't have happened. Then I was watching the documentaries on each one where they would be talking to all these older Asian people who said that they felt like, okay, we were finally being represented on screen. Yeah. Is it right by our standards? No. But if it made the Chinese people at the time feel more accepted, maybe a little bit of a mulligan on it. Am I saying it's right to do it?
I mean, it's sort of like white chicks. Is that offensive to you as a white man? I'm not offended by it. I mean, everybody's done it. I don't think it's something
you could make fun of the population. I think at the time, I would sit there and say when it was made, no. I could imagine that a younger generation might find it offensive now.
Which one? White chicks?
White chicks.
I think it's hysterical.
No, but we're a different age. We're coming from a different time.
Well, then again, you got this generation that gets offended by everything.
Well, I mean, the thing is, to continue what Joe was saying, what I'm saying is that you can watch stuff from its time and enjoy it for what it is.
Exactly.
Would you repeat the same thing today? No, you wouldn't.
Probably not, Matt, because things have changed.
As far as the way people are portrayed, there have been far worse ways that different racial and ethnic groups have been portrayed in movies. Like, obviously, the minstrel show is something you know, that's obviously a lot worse. The way people were portrayed by
what about the Indians in the old westerns?
Yeah.
What about the natives in the old King Kong movie?
Yeah, exactly. Like there were portrayals that weren't meant to be weren't meant to humanize people. Like we portrayed these people as savages. Yeah. In that case, I'd say yes, those were wrong.
I'd say those are absolutely wrong.
But when the object of something is to make you understand and accept somebody who might not be the person you see every single day, then in that case, I don't have a problem with it.
I don't think Al Jolson was a racist, you know, people like that. I mean, they just... I think that people were doing blackface back in the day.
Well, I mean, the thing is again, we're kind of looking at something back then.
It's 100 years ago almost.
I mean, well, it wasn't considered racist at the time. Now it is. That's the difference. I mean, you got to look at what was at the time of anything. I mean, they're, you know.
But the point being is I don't think anything should be eradicated because you don't like it.
I agree. If you don't like it, just don't watch it.
Just don't watch it.
I also think that in terms of history, nothing should ever be eradicated because even if it's wrong, then at least let's learn from it and let's let it exist.
Precisely.
Let's not pretend it never happened because you're doing an injustice then. You know, blackface, yellowface, all that stuff, absolutely, it's wrong. It shouldn't fucking exist, but it does. And if we pretend it doesn't, then we're not learning anything from why we shouldn't do it.
You know, it's a bit like canceling Song of the South in a way.
I don't think anything
should be canceled. Gone with the Wind. I'm sorry. All this cancel culture stuff is no good for anybody.
Warner Brothers, I think out of everybody has gotten it more right than anybody because like I have a lot of the old Warner DVDs up here and a lot of them will have like old Looney Tunes and old, you know, and they would just put a little thing up front saying, this is just the way people viewed things at the time. That's just how it is because I don't think you should get rid of it because I think if you get rid of it, I think you're doing an even greater disservice to people now because I think we should see this stuff and we should learn from, this is the way things were portrayed back then. I'm not saying it's right, but we've grown as a civilization since then. I think that's the best way to look at it.
And another thing is that you have to learn from the past mistakes to make a brighter future anyway.
Yes.
And if you eradicate the past, you're not going to learn. You're going to just, in another 20 years time, you're just going to, if you eradicate it in 20 years time, you're going to repeat it. That's what's going to happen.
Yeah, sadly so.
Basically, yeah. If we don't talk about the Holocaust, someone's going to come around and do the same thing again because, oh.
Well, they are doing it. They're doing it in China. Nobody cares.
Well, they're doing it in Nigeria.
You know, it's terrible.
Yeah.
The Uyghurs they're doing it in Nigeria at the moment as well.
Yeah, and nobody's intervening.
But you know, but the thing is, they don't have oil, and it doesn't matter.
Yeah, so. exactly.
But you know, but the thing, but I mean, what the thing about La Cage aux Folles, I saw this back in 1978, 1979 when it came on HBO. It was a big show on HBO.
Oh, that's right, it was. It was.
And I watched it, and I watched the sequels, and I remember loving. I was like. And I remember sitting down with my dad and watching it. And my dad and my stepmother were all, you know, laughing and really enjoying it because
it's great.
Well, there's a heart. It's heart. And the thing is, you're laughing with them. You're not laughing at them.
Exactly.
And that's the key.
And another feel-good movie along these lines was Victor Victoria. I loved that movie. And they were talking about, they were upset about that, you know, and it's like, how can you be upset about that? That was one of the best.
Well, see, Victor Victoria, what they wanted to do, they wanted to do La Cage aux Folles. They wanted to make the American remake at that time.
Right.
But they realized that they wouldn't be able to get away with it through the censors and because of family values at the time that they couldn't do it. But they realized that they took the French film Victor Victoria, they realize that using a female playing a male, that way the male, when she falls in love with a male, it would work. So they could kind of tell the same kind of story, but still keep the family values and still keep it a family-friendly film at the same time. So, but still, they'll still have the hint of the things like, and I think Victor Victoria is one, a great film. I think they did a fantastic job. So in a way, I'm kind of glad that Family Values was along around that time because we wouldn't get Victor Victoria because that's a great film in its own.
Me and my mother watched that movie. It was on HBO. HBO was kind of groundbreaking in letting some of that stuff come out and having those movies out. But
Alex Karras, a football player, playing a homosexual character. He had
which James movie was Gardner. That? Oh, Alex Karras. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
and you had James Gardner thinking he's in love with a male, even though it's a female.
Yeah, that movie was just fantastic.
And Leslie Ann Warren is fantastic as well.
I just loved it.
And the great Robert Preston, who was another actor.
I loved Robert Preston, especially in the end when all them guys are trying to pick him up. You knew they kept that clip.
But he died living in the closet.
Did he really?
Yeah.
That's you see that's what's sad to me.
I love Robert Preston.
Recently, the woman that the A League of Their Own was based on, mm-hmm. She's 90 years old and just came out as gay, and it breaks my heart.
All those years she couldn't love who
all
she
those years
to love.
You couldn't be yourself. That bothers me. Because you know what? Mm-hmm. Fuck what everybody else thinks. Just do what you want to do. Do what works for you. It bothers the shit out of me that we forced people into a closet and there's people coming out now at 90. Someone I work with, her uncle recently came out of the closet because her mother was, his mother was extremely strict. And as my coworker put it, that bitch lived till 90. So her kid, her son couldn't come out of the closet until he was in his 60s. Utterly ridiculous.
The funny thing about that, though, which is kind of sad, is that I think that parents kind of know by that time. You know, if basically, let's put it this way. If you're, let's say you're 70 years old and your 40-year-old son is living in a one-room flat with a male flatmate in the last 20 years, and you haven't guessed what's going on. There's something, you know, you know what's going on. You just don't want to think about it or address it. You know what I mean?
People don't bother anybody. They don't. They really are. Well, you got your militants in any society that are going to, you know, make waves.
If,
But
if you got a son and his name is Jason and he loves track lighting, and
there you go with the joke. No, it's Rick, be gay. No, it's Rick, Steve, or Mark with track lighting.
Yeah, Rick, Steve, or Mark. Yeah. You know, the chances of them being gay can be quite high.
I've never understood that kind of hatred. That people are ignorant, don't understand.
Well, a lot of it comes down to religion, I think. That's for
yes.
You know, and you know, because if you look at the hatred that is pointed towards homosexuals, it tends to come from a religious kind of a backing.
Yeah. Up.
And the worst case about it is that they always quote Leviticus when they're quoting.
Right. Yeah.
The worst thing about Leviticus, yeah. I mean, the worst thing about Leviticus is like the most horrible book in the Bible. Anyway,
it is. And it's god awful.
And it damns everyone. It damns women.
You can't even have colorful clothes.
It damns women who've been widowed. It damns anyone that's basically. It damns children who haven't given. Damned women who haven't given birth by the age of 16 in it as well. And like, these people all need to be stoned. And you know, so you're thinking, okay, like
clearly this guy had issues. Whoever wrote Leviticus.
Well, another thing is that the Bible sequence that they do that gay that the Christian community and the Jewish and other communities Leviticus is Old Testament here. The unforgiving God. When Christ was born, God kind of softened when he had a son, but he was quite
all. That was a totally different God. I think that they had different gods in the Old Testament because they're talking about a really bipolar being here. So I think in the ancient world, they had several gods. They don't want to discuss it, but they broke up the Bible a bit. They weren't talking about just one God in the Old Testament. So you must delve in the rabbit hole deeper.
But the funny thing about the Bible, when you read the Bible, is that everything has like two or three meanings to it, depending on how you want to look at it. And what they quote from Leviticus in chapter 13 is, "He who lieth with man as with woman shall be punished." Now that could be adultery, bisexuality, or homosexuality,
could depending be anything. On how you want
to look at it. Yeah, but it's quite funny.
I don't know what Noah's excuse was, but.
Well, you know, when Jehovah Witnesses knock on my door, I ask them two questions. If incest is so bad, how did Noah and his family repopulate the world?
People, you got to give them credit, though. They are on a mission. They get out in our van like gangbusters.
The other question you have to ask is this. If Adam and Eve are on Earth, and Adam and Eve have Cain, Abel, and Seth, Cain slew Abel. So that leaves Adam, Eve, Cain, and Seth. Cain ran off with his wife. Who did he run off with? If these are the only four people.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was just about to say. I was like, okay, if it really started with Adam and Eve, where did everyone else come from?
I know. Yeah. That's the part that, you know, and that's where you got to say this is mythology, because you've got the Epic of Gilgamesh. You've got the other Sumerian and Assyrian and all these other texts. Well, everybody has their Garden of Eden in their beginning.
So. The Moses storyline is from Egyptian mythology.
Yeah.
You know, it was
Jesus Christ. Even the story of Jesus.
Picking from a bunch of places. So that's
it's not a good book. My mom's Christian and whatnot. I'm a Christian as well.
But. I mean, I'm quite religious, and but I also think that yourself that, you know, if you look at Jesus, he's born, he disappears, comes back at the age of 10 for like a little story there about this is my father's house.
Yeah.
And then disappears through 32. It's like, where the hell was he from birth to 32?
Well, they've got books all over the Far East about where they say he was traveling to the Far East and all that. There's all kinds of documents.
Yeah, but for what? From the age of like birth to 32?
Yeah,
and Joseph just disappears.
Joseph disappears, precisely. So he just disappears from the story. And I like the idea that everyone thought that Jesus was white. It's like, if he was, it'd be like Hera going, find the white boy.
Yes, find the Jeffrey Hunter lookalike, because that's what everybody thinks Jesus looked like, was from Robert King of
Powell.
Kings.
Look for Robert Powell.
But, yeah.
But another thing could be like, look for the white boy who's got a really bad burn, a sunburn. Like running around in the desert.
I know. Jesus probably had the dark hair, the darker skin. It's just like, you know, he was Arabic.
He'd be Palestinian looking.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah.
Jesus was a hippie.
He really was.
He was.
Love one another. Doesn't matter what
you did. I didn't have a bad story. He didn't have a bad message. Of course, they killed him for it.
God likes Christians more than anybody anyway, because God gave us bacon. We're the only religion that can eat it.
No, Jesus loves sinners. So I am totally in like Flynn. I'm not worried about it. We are all sinners.
It's amazing to me how this message of love everybody got so
convoluted,
twisted around. And it's was it Gandhi that said I love your Christ, I don't love
I just don't like the I don't like
the Christians because they're so much not like their Christ,
basically.
I think we got to be a bit fair here, is that the Jews hate the Muslims hate the Christians hate the Jewish, and so on and so forth. It's a huge circle. And they all hate each other. And the thing is, the worst thing about it, they're all praying to the same God.
And then when you
break this up, you know, there's so many different dimensions within the Jewish religion. They don't, the conservative Jews don't like the Hasidic Jews, and the Hasidic Jews don't like the, the progressive Jews. And same thing in the Muslim religion, that happens as well. Right. And the thing is, and even in the
Protestants,
Christians,
so like the Catholics hate the Baptists,
the Baptists hate the Protestants hate Jehovah's hate the Mormons. It's like, and they're all praying to the same people. That's what they know, and they're thinking.
And everybody hates the First Assembly Church of Christ.
what I find a bit weird is, you would think that all these religions, instead of hating each other for believing in the same overall God, that they basically would actually hate the Buddhists, because they don't believe in anything that these people believe in.
The Buddhists got it going on. They're in the reincarnation.
But it's always quite funny that, you know, these other religions here don't want to mess with the Buddhists. But they rather fight amongst themselves. Like, if you're praying to the God, if you're praying to the same God we all believe in, who does it better? But it all comes down to finances and money anyway.
Yeah.
You know, we're better than you are. And if you think that we're better, you can come join us and give us some more money. So we're more popular.
Pretty much.
So let's rate this film, The Cage Aux Folles, before we go into the Birdcage. How many stars would you give this, Vicky?
I would give it 5. I loved it. I thought it was great. I think it's a feel-good movie. And I like how the people portrayed, you know, brought out the humanity of the gay population, that they're not some kind of weirdos. They love, they have dinner, they have homes, they have families, they have lives, you know. I liked it a lot.
What about yourself, Joe?
Absolutely love it. Like I said, after I saw it, I went and bought the Criterion Blu-ray. I think it's a fantastic movie. I love the message of, let's just everybody get along. And you know what? If we are going to turn on somebody, let's turn on that asshole who hates us for no fucking reason. I love that. I love that message. Fuck him. But they did
try to help him, though, kind of, sort of.
They did. And then he couldn't help himself.
Yeah.
He couldn't help himself. His bigotry got the better of him at the end. And good, fuck him. Fuck everyone like him. But all overall, yes, don't hate people for just trying to live their lives.
Yeah, there is no reason for that.
Absolutely no reason for that. So as far as the message goes, I love it. I can see why some people in the gay community might be offended by the character of Albin. But the way I see it is, if it, and again, this might not be my place, but it's just my opinion, if it led to people being more accepting of the gay community, then absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm totally.
He was so sweet, though.
That's the thing that gets me.
I don't think they had a problem with Albin. I think it was the housekeeper or the butler.
The housekeeper was the best part. I mean, I don't know how you do that.
I think that's the reason why they have a little bit of problem with that character. I don't think it's Albin.
But he was the comedy relief, though, I think. And maybe he was going over the top a little bit, but it was so funny.
As I said before, the actor that was playing him is like that in real life. So.
Oh, well, that's what you're saying, yeah. He was so good, though.
I looked up some interviews at around the time, and he was interviewing me. he was either in being interviewed in character or he's extremely effeminate. So in that case,
it's really nothing that you could really be offended by if that's the way the actor was in real life.
It's just the screaming they do, you know, like the woo, the noises, and I mean, well, it was just so damn funny.
But I also think I'm going to give this film a 5-star. I love this film. I think it, you know.
I love the heart. I
like the grittiness of it. There's a grittiness.
Yes.
In this film. Yeah. As we get into the other one, that's true. It is gritty.
It doesn't feel glossy. It feels realistic. And I do think that when you look at something like this, that Cage Aux Folles is not a documentary. It is a entertainment piece.
It's a
based on the play. And of course, because it's based on the play, the character are going to be a bit wider, broader than you're going to find, because it is,
considering that it was in the 70s, though. Don't you think the 70s were just gritty anyway, movie wise?
Well, I mean, look at Saturday Night Fever. Everyone goes, what a feel good film. I mean, that is a dirty, gritty film, Saturday Night Fever.
It's a what?
It's a dirty, gritty film, Saturday Night Fever. It is.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, you got Donna Pasco's getting gangbanged in the back of the car while she's on Valium, and then you got, all the women are throwing themselves out. I mean, basically, it's a film about
Fran Drescher. She was in that. She was like 16, wasn't she? Yeah. Fran Drescher.
But the thing is, you don't realize it, but you have to remember when time moves on, people have an idea what something is. And then when you revisit it, that you actually see, like, Dirty Dancing is like a great film, but then when you rewatch it, you realize how unwatchable film it really is.
Especially the poor TV-made movie. That was just like, I can't believe they even did.
Well, Dirty Dancing, I mean, at the time when it came out, I enjoyed it.
I loved it when it came out.
Watch it now. It's a bad movie. It's a really bad movie.
I still like it, but it's kind of bad. You're right.
Yeah. But, it's a bit like Pretty in Pink. It's like, you watch Pretty in Pink at the time. It's like, oh, what a fantastic prom dress. You look at it, I'm like, what the fuck is she wearing?
Yeah. It was the 80s. Come on.
But what I'm saying is time has a weird way of playing things in your mind that you might think. And then you revisit them and you're like, oh,
did I really like that?
Or sometimes you'll find something that I hated at the time and then you rewatch it and you think, God, this is fucking fantastic. But I hate
every woman's biggest thing back in the 70s and 80s, the blue eyeshadow. We all did it.
So you just never know how anything's going to play until you revisit something anyway. So, well, this brings us to The Birdcage, which is a 1996 American comedy film directed by Mike Nichols and was adapted by Elaine May. And starring Robin Williams, Gene Hackman, Nathan Lane, and Diane Weist, Dan Futterman and Clarissa Flockhart before Ally McBeal, and Hank Azera, Christine Baranski appeared in the supporting roles. It's an English language remake of the 1978 Franco-Italian film La Cage aux Folles and the musical of the same name. What we're going to do is cut to the trailer of The Birdcage and be right back.
Pop, I'm getting married. It's a girl. I met her at school. It's this wonderful... Are you upset? But let me tell you why.
Don't use that tone to me.
What tone?
That sarcastic, contemptuous tone that means you know everything because you're a man and I know nothing because I'm a woman.
You're not a woman.
Oh, you bastard.
Are you crazy? You can't get married. It's out of the question.
We've been sleeping together for a year.
Oh, God. Has he been tested?
Oh, Kevin!
Yes, and so have I.
Oh!
Who's his father? His father is in the arts.
You do an eclectic celebration of the dance. You do Fosse, Fosse, Fosse. You do Martha Graham, Martha Graham, Martha Graham. Or Madonna, Madonna, Madonna.
But you keep it all inside.
What does the mother do? She's a housewife.
Oh, I could play it straight.
You take your knife and you smear. Men smear.
Smear,
that's it.
Yeah.
Get the pinky down. Oh. I hold the knife boldly in the strength.
No, I'm coming like pierce the toast.
Al, you old so-and-so. How do you feel about that call today? I mean, the Dolphins, 4th-and-3 play on their 30-yard line with only 34 seconds to go.
How do you think I feel? Betrayed, bewildered.
Call me.
Perfect. Won't you come in?
Senator Keeley. Mrs. Keeley, come here and give me a hug.
I've never felt such tension. It's like riding a psychotic horse towards a burning stable.
Oh God, it's a nightmare. Get up,
everybody, and sing. Something about the father and Mrs. Cole. I can't put my finger on
it's
it.
It's nothing.
What do you mean?
It's nothing.
It is something.
It is nothing.
Something very strange is going on. We
are family. Hello, welcome back to the Birdcage, Literary License Podcast. And Vicky, what are your thoughts of the Birdcage?
I don't think I could possibly love a movie any more than I love this movie. I mean, I was like, I was kind of in a cruddy, I've watched it a long time ago, and I'm kind of in a cruddy mood, and I decided to watch it again last night for this, and I just immediately just felt a lot better, and I kept laughing because Robin Williams just knocks it out of the park in this. He just does. I mean, not only do you not realize what he was probably going through in his life that you weren't aware of, you know, which kind of gives it that much oomph and warmth to it. But I just love how they're portrayed. I love how he acts. I mean, I love how they dress these guys. I love how they get the huge crucifix and hang it up in the living room, the life-size crucifix. What's his name? He plays the Guatemalan. Oh my God, what was his name?
Oh, Hank Azaria.
Oh my God. Every time he spoke, and I was reading about how when they were doing the director of the movie, every time that, well, especially when Robin Williams had his one moment where they let him act gay, when he was doing the Bob Fosse stuff, the guy had to keep leaving so they get through the scene because the directors were laughing so hard they couldn't do the scene. So they had to leave to get it cut right.
That's the biggest thing to me that I loved about this movie more than anything is you could tell that they let Robin Williams, Hank Azaria, yeah. Nathan Lane, they let them just ad lib as much as they wanted, it seems like.
So fun. It was such a fun movie. Again, though, more so in this movie than the other one, I wanted to kill the son more in this movie than I wanted to kill him in the other one. You know, it just seemed cruel. And that's the only downside of this movie. I know that you gotta have an antagonist. You gotta have something to revolve it, whatever around. So the comedy value comes with, you know, the situation that evolved with Gene Hackman and whatnot. But God, it bothered me. It just did. I don't know why.
I felt exactly the same way. And I wonder if, and you know, no disrespect to the actor in the French, version, but I wonder if it's just because Nathan Lane is such a great fucking actor that he portrayed that heartbreak better maybe than it was in the French film. I don't know.
Well, he was so sad and he wanted to leave and then he was going to go to the cemetery, you know, and it's just stuff like that. I mean, who wouldn't be hurt, gay, female, or otherwise, that you're, you know, someone who you raised as your child is embarrassed to you because somebody's an asshole. And they're coming over to the house.
But you know why I think the son's character is like that? The son character is the normal audience walking into the situation. And then it's through the pain and heartache and how he's willing to sacrifice his own dignity for the love of his son that makes the son turn around and have like, we're not doing this anymore. And I accept you and I love you for who you are. So basically, that's to show the son coming in is like, that's the actor. That's basically the audience. And basically, like, okay, this is
what was his name? Agador Spartacus. I mean, it don't get any better. It just doesn't. And then he kept wanting the wigs. He kept stealing his wigs and wearing the wigs, you know? And I mean, and he had those crazy get-ups when he was doing the housework, and then he didn't want to wear regular shoes and the high heels. I just loved it. I just can't even sing enough praises over this movie. There's just nothing wrong with it.
Doing Lucy and Ricky at the same time, which is fantastic.
Oh my God! And the ad-libbing.
Which actually I'd seen on Broadway. Mike Nichols directed Spamalot, and Hank Azaria, David Hyde Pierce were in it. Tim Curry was supposed to be King Arthur, but the night that I got tickets to, I should have figured it was so easy to get tickets. It would have been on a night that Tim Curry wasn't there.
Oh my God. But that was so cool.
But it was the weekend that I went was like either the week or the weekend after the Dick Cheney hunting accident where he shot that guy in the face. And Hank Azaria.
Not that it's funny, but it kind of is.
Hank Azaria was one of the knights who say me, and he turned it into an entire bit about it's your turn to shoot Mr. Vice President, pointing a gun at David Hyde Pierce, which I think was fantastic. You talk about ad-libbing, and that was directed by the director of The Birdcage, Mike Nichols, so who I've always loved. I love The Graduate also. I love his movie. I love his stage work that I've seen by him. But yeah, this movie is another. It's fantastic, and I hadn't seen it since around the time that it first came out on video, and it used to play on cable a lot, and I used to catch it on cable a lot. My roommate has the Blu-ray, so we popped that in and we watched them back to back. My God, the level.
I was crying. I was laughing so hard, though. I mean, I literally cried.
And I don't know. Again, this could be because I've seen The Birdcage first. It could be because I'm more used to that kind of more glossy, big budget aspect. But I adore both movies. I absolutely love both of them. I feel like it's just the ad-libbing in this movie that I think carries it beyond the original. Yeah. I love both, but I like this one because I feel like Robin Williams and Nathan Lane and Hank Azaria are all just trying to crack each other up.
Yeah.
And I just got that feeling. And the movie, I think
Gene Hackman and drag. I mean, come on.
And the interesting thing about Nathan Lane is that he just came off of Broadway winning a Tony Award for Guys and Dolls. And this is the first time doing a major movie acting role.
I didn't realize who was he in Guys and Dolls? Was he Sky or was he?
No, he was the guy who sings Sit Down, You're Rocking the Boat with Peter Gallagher.
Really?
Oh. And, yeah.
Oh, okay. I don't remember the character's name, but yeah, I did not think that would be. I didn't think that would be him. I thought he would have been either Sky Masterson or the other lead.
To be honest, the best role in it is the guy who sings "Sit Down, You're Rocking the Boat." Because what happens when you sing that song? It stops the show.
Yeah,
the show stops.
The house comes down,
and you end up doing like three or four encores of this before the audience is ready to move on.
Yeah, I could see that would be a star-making role. Yeah,
they went into such a production to change the house for this family. You know, I mean, they did everything to take every nuance of their life and anything that they did or anything. And I mean, I think that's kind of sad that you have to I mean, I sometimes, you know, when people come over, there's some things I hide. You know, I think things they don't need to read or my bong or. But not the whole house, you know.
But you know what I also like about this as well, though, because the house is so gay, and I can say that because I can say words like that. This house was overly gay, and the thing is, even when they took stuff out of it, they still couldn't get the gay out of the house.
You know what I mean? Didn't they have prancing men on the plates or something? The dinnerware?
No, they had. No, they weren't prancing men. They were men having a circle jerk.
Oh, is that what it was? Yeah, okay, yeah. Excellent.
It's basically men bent over having anal sex all the way around the plate.
I didn't get a good look at it. How funny.
They had to put up the sheet to block off part of the room.
I don't know how you don't love this movie. I mean, just the sheer comedy of it. Like I said, the only time they let Robin Williams act like, I mean, he was trying to portray a masculine gay person. I guess you would say that he would be the husband probably in this relationship, clearly. You know, and that was the only time they let him, you know, do his gayness. was when he was telling them how to dance up on the stage. And I mean, I think I watched that part 3 times.
But, you know, I'm glad that I'm glad that they rein him in, Robin Williams, because sometimes, and this works out really well. Sometimes if they don't rein him in, you get too much of the Robin Williamisms going on. And it's because they let him have his frogo in that one sequence, it works really well, because that way he was more reserved in the rest of the movie.
Well, he had to be reserved.
Otherwise you would have had 2 Alberts.
Can you imagine how hard that was to be reserved as much as he was in that?
You know, Robin Williams works at his best when he's reserved. If you look at Robin Williams' best movies, it's World According to Garp, 1 Hour Photo, Insomnia, and Dead Poets Society. It was a good film.
I was going to bring up Insomnia first. I was like, Insomnia, he's fucking fantastic.
Yeah.
That's true. I forgot about those other roles.
I love, you know, A Good Morning Vietnam, because that allowed him to do his.
I love that movie. He was fantastic.
Awakenings as well is another one where he wasn't allowed to do his Williamisms. But you look at the films that basically all of a sudden he goes into his Williamisms, they don't really live up to, you know, there might be 1 or 2. Mrs. Doubtfire, he just fantastic because he can do his Williamisms because he's in another character and that works well. But, you know, Dead Poets Society, I do like the film, but when he starts breaking into it, it's totally out of character for this movie. Right. Sometimes.
Robin Williams, more than any other comedic actor, like, I just love him so much when he was doing these roles where he was, like, he was able to kind of meld it better than I think anybody else.
Well, he was a physical comedian. I mean,
But you mentioned, I forgot about Awakenings. Awakenings is such a heartbreaking movie.
I haven't seen that. Is it really sad? Do I need to watch it?
Robin Williams is a doctor in it's the word I'm looking for here, Keith.
in a mental health ward where basically the patients are catatonic. And Robert De Niro was one of those patients.
Or what?
Catatonic,
okay.
And Robert De Niro is a true story.
Oh, okay. Yeah. What's it called again?
Awakenings.
Okay.
It won the Oscars at that time.
Robert De Niro.
And to be honest, I think Robin Williams. I like The Fisher King, but I think Robin Williams is better in Awakenings than he was The Fisher King. But they gave him the Oscar for Fisher King, didn't they? So.
Did he only get that one Oscar?
He didn't do. I mean,
Good Will Hunting. Didn't he win an Oscar for Good Will Hunting? Or no? Am I wrong on that?
Oh, that was also an excellent movie. That was excellent.
I don't know if he won for that. I know that the Ben Affleck and Matt Damon won for the screenplay.
For the screenplay, yeah. I'll look real quick.
He was nominated for The World According to Garp as well.
Robin Williams, I think more than any other comedic actor, was able to just knock it out of the park more often when he won one Oscar when he performed something serious. He won for Good Will Hunting, was nominated for The Fisher King, Dead Poets Society, and Good Morning Vietnam.
Okay.
But he got the one. He won
for Good Will Hunting.
I think with Robin Williams that you have to have a strong director.
Definitely.
Yeah. Keep him reined in at all times.
I wonder if he was like, I know that he had his problems though, but I mean, somebody that brilliant, that funny, that physically and mentally
he had an actual mental problem,
is what I'm asking.
Yeah, he was bipolar. He had extreme highs and extreme lows. He had it managed. I think the most astounding thing that you say about Robin Williams is that he helped more people in his lifetime than anybody that you ever know. And none of this stuff came out until after he died, when you realize that all the charities he was giving to, all the stuff that he would show up and do things for charity, all the families he was housing and taking care of with his own money.
Yeah.
And he never let anyone know. It's not like a celebrity that goes, oh, I'll get to this and I get to that. He did all this because it didn't matter. He just gave.
Yeah.
He just felt it was the right thing to do.
And that's a remarkable person. If someone's telling you how much they're giving to everyone, they're not a remarkable person. If someone's just doing it and not telling you about it, they're a remarkable person. because they're actually doing it for the good of the what they're doing for their beliefs than doing it so that way you think that they're a good person.
That's true.
You know, it's a bit like we had that problem with when we saved those three orangutans with the Media Bits Litter Agency.
Right.
Everyone's like going, how much money? It doesn't matter. I'm not telling people how much money it raised. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Because I'm not going to go, oh, look at us, pat us on the back. Tim, we done good. Mm-hmm. It's not about that. It's about us. You know, it's not about us. Look at how good we done. It's about the cause. And you don't need to be thankful for the cause. You know, I give, you know, the Literary License Podcast, we do give money to charities and stuff like that, but it's not anybody's business what we give and how much we give and that, because it's about helping. That's it. You know, I give to charity. I give
to
charity.
If you're in a position to help someone and you do it and you don't ask anything in return, then that's what makes you somebody that I think,
exactly.
I think that's more noble than going to the press and screaming about it.
Precisely. I mean, for me, for instance, like if I help anybody out or anything like that, you know, they go, oh, what do I owe you? I go, you don't owe me anything. Just help. I can just help two or three. I can help someone else when they need. Just pay it forward.
Yeah, exactly.
I've done
that. Pay it forward stuff really does come in handy for people. And it does make me, I think it makes you feel good if you help people. You know, I don't know. I just, it makes me feel better about myself. And I know it helps the other person. And I know when they get a chance, they're going to help somebody. So, actually, it's a very good
thing. But nothing's worse than when someone helps you and all they talk about is how they helped you.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah. Nothing like the narcissist. I did this for you. I did that for you.
It's like it doesn't matter what you've done for anybody. Just do it. Don't even mention it again.
Yeah. Fuck y'all.
if you're doing it for the accolades and you're doing it for the wrong reason, I think – hell, it's going to be a religion heavy episode. That's even part of the Christianity thing is if you give in secret, you don't, if you're making a big deal out of it, then you're only serving yourself. So just Robin Williams helping.
And just remember, when it comes down to money, never loan people money that you're willing to lose.
Well, that's true. Also,
we got to give we still got to give credit to Diane Weist and Calista Flockhart too in this.
Calista Flockhart, I thought, was a bit flat.
You think? Well, I don't think her character was written.
But yeah, I think that's like Vicky said, I think that's the character. I think that character just isn't really given much to do except be there.
I think she's a flat actress anyway. I think that she, and I don't. I mean, the thing is, but to be fair, it's really hard to own yourself to basically bring yourself up when you got Robin Williams, Gene Hackman, Nathan Lane, Diane Weist, you know, Hank Azira, Christine Baranski, and you have these strong actors around you, and here you are doing your first movie.
One thing I had to ask, this is the part I didn't understand, maybe you guys caught, I'm sure you guys caught it better than I think I turned my head or did something for a second, I kind of lost track, but okay, so he had a baby with her, and that culminated in the son being born. And are they still attracted to each other, kind of, sort of?
No, she's basically his fag hag. She was a fag hag in the day. Okay. I don't know if I'm assuming I can still use, I can use that word. I don't know if you guys can, but I can. but basically, they were in theater together. She was the fag hag. She was, you know, all us gays always have at least one or two great female friends that we keep around all the time. I have eight or nine myself. The thing is we do fun stuff with them, and then they did a show together, so they have all, you know, it's a bit.
Well,
like,
they seem like there was something very deep there.
Well, it's a bit like you, you know, me and you, or me and Pam, Spencer back home, you know, whoever we can friends with. I mean, the thing is we're really close. And we just, you know, we're very, very close. You know what I mean? We discuss everything, and there's that closeness that I really don't have with any other people except for my girlfriend, sort of thing. and so I think it's more that than having a thingy. And then you have that thing is like, you know, I mean, I've been told that by couple of my girlfriends is like, oh, it's like, oh, if you're only you're straight sort of thing, because it's like, because,
I don't because, think I can handle you straight.
No, but what, the reason being is because we're such great friends, and there's no secrets between us, and we share so much, and we're just comfortable with each other. You know what I mean? That I would probably make that they probably would be my perfect wife, and I would be the perfect husband, because there's nothing pulling us apart. We're together because we're being together.
I just kind of like now they kind of bounced off each other a little bit, because she clearly was still interested in him, because in both film versions, she's after his chest hair.
in both versions, she was clearly attractive. But there's also another thing that if you work a lot in theater and work a lot in movies, there's always, because you're working so closely together for so long every day, and for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks, whatever it is, you're the only person I'm seeing every, you know, these same 10, 15 people are the same people I'm seeing every week. There's always little relationships, little hookups that end up happening like off the side, because I'm spending 8-9 hours with you. You know, you're laughing at all my jokes in between sets, and hey, we might grab a drink later, and well, you know, all of us are away from everybody else.
It happens.
It happens, exactly. There's always little hookups.
In theater, it's even stronger as well theater, because what happens in theater is you have like 6 to 8 weeks, depending on what show you're doing. But yeah, 6 to 8 weeks, and basically, that's during the day that they're practicing. Then when the show goes on, then you can finish about 11, 12 o'clock, and then you might go out with these people afterwards, because you need to wind down before you get home, because who's ever at home, you know, you're going to be kind of wired if you're not careful.
Yeah.
And then what happens that you'll find yourself doing is that once the show's on its feet, you still have to come back during the day and rehearse.
Yeah.
And that's not including the two shows on Thursday, the two shows on Saturday, you know? True. So, and then when you are getting home, then you're probably sleeping until 11, 12 o'clock. And then when you're getting up, you're getting ready to go to the theater.
Also, being
family.
20, 21, 22 years old and working in theater where most of the other guys were gay. And I was the only straight one. There was a lot of times I'd be going out for drinks with a lot of the women later. So things will always happen on those things. It happens in movies. It happens more in theater. But
especially on tours. Tours are even worse.
Oh, I bet.
Yeah, you hit the road with people.
You're all going to a strange town. You don't know anyone but each other. You're eating together, sleeping together sometimes together, but hoteling together as well. And basically, and then you're all moving together to the next town. You know, it's right. Like, and you're doing that for like 6 months to a year. With these same people.
Well, I imagine it is close-knit like regular family. That's what I liked about this movie, though, because it was more family-oriented than some of the heterosexual films and stuff that I'd seen. They actually loved each other. And so that when the problem in itself, you know, they're working together to try to solve this problem because, you know, Gene Hackman's an asshole. But I kind of liked how this one ended a little bit more because Gene Hackman seemed to come around a little bit.
It gives you hope. It gives you hope that
maybe
if these people, maybe if these really, you know, uptight people get to know them, that they'll come around and be like, hey, you know, and I think they went out of their way to make make Albert in this one say things that were more traditional family values things, so that Gene Hackman's character could be like, yeah, these people believe in family values. It's just, why do I care who they go to bed with? And I think this movie had a little bit more hope than the
French
version.
I think this has a lot to do with Elaine May, though.
With what?
Elaine May, the scriptwriter.
Maybe. Because that was one of the changes here.
You got to remember, Elaine May wrote Tootsie.
Oh, did she? Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
So, wow, she wrote two fantastic movies then. I haven't really followed her career much, so I don't know what else she had written.
She's kind of like a thinking man's Nora. What's that female?
Nora Ephron?
She's like a thinking woman's Nora. And if you notice, like she did Primary Colors with John Travolta. He wrote that as well, which, you know, Wolf, Labyrinth, Dangerous Minds. But if you notice, her characters are always quite, they're very strong characters, but with a lot of heart behind them.
Wolf was another Mike Nichols movie I liked. Wow.
Is that Jack Nicholson? Was Wolf Jack Nicholson?
Yeah. Michelle Pfeiffer? Jack Nicholson, Michelle Pfeiffer, James Spader.
James Spader was such a dick in that movie.
Yeah. I completely
He always plays a dick, another, though.
That's another Mike Nichols movie I like. It felt like this one. Whereas the French version, the guy is exposed because he just can't help himself but be a bigot. It feels like this one kind of had a little bit more of like a hopeful thing. Like, hey, look, there's some assholes. Like, Rush Limbaugh's a complete asshole. And Gene Hackman's character is kind of an asshole, but you kind of want to hope that these people are going to be a little bit more accepting of the community.
Right.
And I feel like
Hackman is not so much an asshole. The asshole character goes more to the National Enquirer journalist. He's the asshole.
Yeah, the journalists or whatever you want to call them. But
we are looking, which is quite interesting, in 1996. This is when media would start changing. This is after OJ and, you know.
Now they knew what they were missing, and let's just ruin everybody's lives and make everybody hate each other. Yeah, the media's just
because to be honest, Hackman's like conservative, but at the same time, when he shows up there, he's trying to get on with them. He's making a conscious effort. He understands that there's something strange going on. He doesn't understand what is going on.
But it's so funny because in this version, he's totally all over the mom. He loves her. He thinks Albert is great, you know, and she's a well-rounded woman.
But another thing that you have with him as well is that, you know, he realizes there's something eccentric going on here, but he's willing to sit there and enjoy himself with this and go along for the ride.
I love Gene Hackman though. Yeah. He's just another one of my faves.
But the only time that he does freak out is not when he finds out about it. It's basically he's like, okay, he's a bit like, oh, but he finds out that the press are outside and that's when he freaks out.
Yeah.
Yes.
So he's not freaked out when it all comes through and all of a sudden all this stuff comes out.
Pure genius.
He gets freaked out when he finds out that the press is outside and then this is where everything kind of goes, uh-oh. That's the
it's just
moment.
Pure genius, though, well, just, how they dress him up. Now, they made him look good. Gene Hackman looked good in drag.
About it, it's kind of how during the Bush administration wanted to make an amendment against gay marriage, but then after it comes out that Dick Cheney's daughter
was gay.
Yeah, was gay. He did an about face on that, and I'm kind of, you know what? I didn't even put it together until just this moment. It's kind of like that.
I didn't
He's
think of
kind of like the Gene Hackman character here.
What happened in 1996? Don't ask, don't tell. Military.
Well, was that only in 96? I thought that was earlier than that.
I thought it was earlier too, but I guess Keith would know better than I. I remember when it started. I just don't remember what year it was.
Yeah, in 1996, I was 15, so I was not as well.
It was under the Clinton administration,
right?
So, I think another reason why this film does have that feel good moment as well, it does benefit where the French one doesn't with a good soundtrack.
Oh, that too.
Yeah.
They had a lot of money in this one. I think that's
obviously. How much did they spend on this production?
For 1996, I'd say
31 million was the budget. Box office 885 million. That's not bad. In return,
and it became a huge hit, which I'm really glad it did.
And I think the cinematographer was Emmanuel Lubezki. I think he did quite a few other outstanding projects as well. Best, but for the cinematography, I'm trying to remember exactly what it was, but he's well known. I thought it was just beautifully done.
The only complaint I would make about this film is that it does have that 90s glossiness to it.
A little bit.
stuff. But saying that, it doesn't feel dated, though. Thank God.
No, I didn't think it was dated at all. I mean, I think it's just as relevant now as it was in 1996.
Well, I talk about dated as far as the look of it goes. Because luckily, whoever dressed these people, because the conservative, let's face it, conservative clothing never go out of style. They kind of always there. And I think, unfortunately, what you have. But I also found that you don't really get a lot of, I think what this film misses a little bit is you don't get a lot of the chorus boys or the chorus drag going on. You don't get any of those performers at all going on. You know, where in the, I think in the original, you kind of get like what's going on backstage a lot more. With the,
who was it they were talking about? He wanted to give them just free coffee. Who did, what the this version?
Oh, they were talking about the Kennedys. In this
the
one,
Kennedys,
the Kennedys,
okay. Because it was the royal family in the other one. Oh.
It was, yeah, some other diplomat or something in the original version. But yeah, it was the Kennedys in this one.
I just thought it was funny that the Kennedys were in his club.
Well, I think they're right about the cinematographer. He won the Oscar for The Revenant, Birdman, and Gravity. Yes. He's nominated for Tree of Life, Children of Men, The New World, Sleepy Hollow, A Little Princess. He's won 144 awards. With 82 nominations where he didn't win. So, yeah, one of the,
pretty outstanding guy.
Absolutely outstanding cinematographer.
I mean, I think another thing is that the difference between the two basically would also be is that drag shows in France is something that the rich elite go to. So if you look at La Cage aux Folles and you look at the audience, they're not a gay audience. They're like a really kind of a witchy looking audience.
Situation. Well, that's the same here when back in the day when they had the really cool drag shows going on, you know, we would go down there. And if they knew you were a regular woman, you know, a woman, you know, you weren't a drag boy, they would friggin' roast you.
But what I'm saying is that the drag shows in France, and you'll notice as a Victor Victoria, it's for rich people. It's right. For the rich. Here, this is maybe, you know, basically, and the Birdcage kind of switches that up, which is true that in America is kind of like, you know, it's not a basically a rich person show. You're not paying £75 a ticket to go see a drag show in America, where you would pay that in France because it's considered, in France, it was considered an art form. In America,
well, all the work they put into it.
Well, it's considered an art form now, but in general, it's not. You know, it's considered an art form now, but at the time, drag is what you do. You went to the gay club to sell drag. You know what I mean? In England and Europe, it's basically, you know, you have to book like 4 or 5 weeks in advance.
Oh wow! Yeah. I didn't realize it was like that.
Oh yeah, we had Madame Jojo's here in London that ran from the 60s to the 90s. Basically, it's like, you know. And then you have, you know, the French, you know, if you look at Victor Victoria, you know, if you notice, everyone in Victor Victoria is dressed to the nines in the audience.
Yeah, that's true. Way,
like in my old neighborhood in Brooklyn, which was, you know, a middle class, you know, lower middle class, working class neighborhood. If I would have gone to a drag show when I lived there, everyone around me would have been like, oh, are you a little, you know, whatever. But now that I live in a much more well-off community and everyone here doesn't give a shit. So maybe in a way it is like that still. I think there's still that, or at least there might be a little bit of stigma among.
Well, to show you the difference. I mean,
I don't care.
We've had drag on in this country on TV regularly. Danny LaRue was a drag artist. He starred in Hello Dolly in the West End as Hello Dolly. And he had his own TV. He had his own variety show. And we also had Dame Edna.
Oh, that's right.
Barry Humphries, you know, and we have a Lily Savage, who's now Paul O'Grady. He's talking about Paul O'Grady being Clary. And it's like, there's a long history of these people just being on regular television, like every Sunday. And they're basically just those characters, those people, you know. So, you know, in America, I think, you know, I think the campus we got was Waylon Flowers and Madam. You remember the guy with the Madam puppet? Do you remember him?
Which one is it?
Waylon Flowers and Madam. Do you remember like the gay guy and Madam, which had like the turban?
I mean,
she was fantastic.
The only drag queen I can think of growing up was RuPaul. I mean, you guys are a little bit older than me, but that's the only
RuPaul kind of normalized it a little bit. I used to, like I said, I used to love his show in the beginning. I don't watch it quite so much now, but I liked it back then.
I could, to be honest, before RuPaul in America, I can't remember any drag queen before that being on television or any man dressed as a woman ever as part of the character. I mean,
I can't.
I mean, you had Monty Python, but that wasn't like they were.
Well, that was
always
different, though.
That was sketch comedy. That was a completely different animal.
I mean, I guess the closest we can come, I guess, is Mae West. Mae West or Cher or Cher or Bette Midler, maybe. But what I'm saying is, like, before RuPaul, I don't remember any Drake artists having their own show in America ever.
I don't saw one either.
There were some people in my old neighborhood in New York that thought Cher was trans, and I was like, I'm pretty sure she's not.
they say that about Jamie Lee Curtis, as though she was a hermaphrodite. That was a rumor going around.
Oh, leave Jamie Lee Curtis alone.
I forgot about that rumor.
That was around the same time that Richard Gere liked
gerbils. His gerbils. Still, inquiring minds want to know. I mean,
and Marilyn Manson had his ribs removed so he could suck his own dick.
Who did?
Marilyn Manson had his ribs removed so he could suck his own dick.
Is that one of those
one of those urban legends too?
Those urban legends. Yeah. Well, that's sort of like Rod Stewart. You know, was hospitalized.
Oh, that.
Yeah, that was true. But who did he suck off?
A lot of people, and that's why he threw up.
Of a lot of people.
He had to get his stomach pumped.
I know.
But
when you think about it now, it's like, God, it's like, you know, you get like porn and basically it's just like, you know, it's like a gangbang and they don't have to get their stomach pumped. So to make that story real, you think like, how many people did he have? Was that supposed to be, really?
Jasmine St. Clair, like 500 and something guys, and she didn't need her stomach pumped. Rod Stewart's a lightweight.
Yeah, apparently.
Actually, talking about people having to come out of the closet late in life, I guess we should probably mention Elvira.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That was just this year, wasn't it?
Last year, yeah.
Last year,
but she's been living in the closet for over 50
years.
Well,
she said for a long time she didn't even know she was gay, really, and then she just realized she loved this person.
I'm saying that she was in a relationship with this person for 20 years before
that, how it came about, she just realized that she just loved this person, and that's what happened.
And this is a gay icon that's afraid to come out of the closet.
Right. So. Yeah, but she's fantastic, and you know, people shouldn't.
No, but I'm just saying. We still have this going on today, sort of thing. But I remember seeing a documentary about it today, and I couldn't figure out who it was, and that just came to me when we were up before the virus. It was today that I saw that. So let's rate
there's
the birdcage.
Go ahead.
What were you saying?
Go ahead, Joe.
What I was gonna say is there's still countries that want to execute people for being gay. So
yeah, like all the Middle Eastern. That's another thing. It's like Disney's big on all this stuff over here, but they won't do it over there. That's for sure.
They put in these characters so that they could cut them out for the markets in the Middle East and China.
We cater so much to China. We just need to stop catering.
I think what you need to remember is that it's a movie. It's a money making thing. And the thing is, if you're going to be able to quadruple your money in a country and money's that important to you, you're probably going to do it.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that they should. I'm not saying it's right or wrong.
No, I'm just saying the hypocrisy of it all.
Oh, I know. My
whole thing is if you didn't fucking force us to make these movies half a fucking billion dollars every single time, we wouldn't have to cater to all these countries that are, you know.
Well, now that we know it can be done again, so.
Well, even Top Gun. Who was it in Top Gun that we were in the new Top Gun? Who was it that we were fighting exactly?
I don't know.
Who were these people attacking us? They went out of their way to make sure that we didn't know who it was.
I don't know. I haven't seen it yet. All I know is glad that they showed a little backbone when it came to China, and that made a big difference to the American population watching it.
It's the new Top Gun. I absolutely love it. I think I'm gonna have to rewatch both of them again to see if I actually do like it more than the original.
Did Val Kilmer have a big role in it, Joe?
He has a part in it. It's obviously because he's so
well. His son is dubbing his voice, right?
I don't know who dubbed his voice.
His
son dubbed his voice in the documentary as well that Val Kilmer did. That's available on Amazon.
He is in the movie, and it is a really, you know. Obviously, knowing everything that's going on with him, it is kind of sad.
It's very sad.
But Top Gun 2, the reason why I think it ends up being successful is that they're actually fighting an invisible villain. They don't mention, as you said before.
Yeah, there's just this logo, and it's not quite Russian. It's not quite China. It's not quite Middle Eastern. We don't know who it is.
It's a bit like those old movies, or you know, they have these old war films, and it's like, and the who you war with, like Chica Booga Binga Bunga, and you're like, that's not even a country.
What was that movie with Kim Jong Un? The funny ass movie. They have
The Interview.
The Interview. Oh my god, I can't. That movie is fucking.
But if
gold.
But my whole gold. Thing. If these movies didn't have to be $500 million.
Why do they have to be $500 million?
Because we're greedy. So we have to make these movies that are going to make $1 billion. So we have to kowtow all these countries, and we shouldn't. Because if you make movies smaller again, then and they have a more, like, if you try to appeal to everybody, you're just going to have bland.
You can't. Movies. There's you're no way you can appeal bland to everybody.
It also depends on what actors you actors cost a lot of money nowadays as well.
So right.
There is this idea that basically, if you don't have a big actor in your film, then your film's not going to get it's not going to get released properly.
I don't know. I see a lot of independent film making a huge rise still. I think COVID was a shot in the ass for them. I do.
Well, you're big, but they don't really make it to the multiplexes.
They don't make it to that. No, they
make
don't.
It to your Netflix and your streaming sort of thing. And there's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that. It makes me sad, kind of. Some of these people aren't going to get a shot. Well, though.
What you need to do is you need to get another Napoleon Dynamite or another Mystic Pizza or
right.
Juno coming out and making money at the multiplex.
It's Everything Everywhere All at Once. That's the big one this year.
I haven't seen that yet. Have you?
Fantastic! I love it.
Is it? Did you like it?
I love that the message is again accept people for who they are. I love that that's ultimately what I felt the message was. And when you get a chance, it just came out on Blu-ray, so the rental's probably like $4 or $5.99 right
now. It's $5.99 right now.
Then yeah, absolutely see it. It's just it's long. It's 2 hours and a half or something like that. But I really really loved it.
Well, Eli, I'll have to give it a shot because I'm all by my lonesome tonight. So.
Yeah, then this might, and there's no Joe Bob, so yeah, tonight.
No, there is no Joe Bob. I hate the end of seasons. They got renewed
for season 5, though, so we'll get more.
Yeah. Everything ended this week. My life is going to suck.
Well, it's summer. That's what happens at summer.
Yeah, yeah, I know. But The Boys is killing me. I really wanted 10 episodes. Like, God dang, don't leave this like this.
I didn't realize it was over. So that means I'll watch everything over the next week.
Oh, my God. You got to watch it. And then tell me what you think.
Well, I mean, Westworld's back, though. So you got Westworld.
Oh, that's right. I can watch Westworld. Yes, I can watch Westworld. So. And Yellowstone is coming up in September or August. So I have a reason to live. Yeah, I'm good.
So on a scale of 5, what would you rate this, starting with you, Vix, The Birdcage?
8. I love this movie. It makes me feel good. And if I guess I was talking to you guys about it today. If I'm in a bad mood, I'm going to just turn this movie on so I can watch Robin Williams make fun of the Bob Fosse thing. It's just a feel-good movie. I don't care if you're
Fosse,
gay, you're not
Fosse,
gay.
Graham.
I know. I mean, I don't care who you like. It's just a feel-good movie, and it really does humanize a population that's been kind of actually victimized. You know, everybody says they're a victim, but this is an actual victimized population, and it's just nice to see that. It's just heartfelt. It's just a warm. It's not even fuzzy, but it's funny. And like I said, that the guy, you're the Guatemalan-ness, you know, I mean, I literally peed my pants every time he walked into the kitchen on this movie, because you never see him in roles like that. You know, it's just God dang funny, but I love it. I can't praise it enough.
What about yourself, Joe?
Same here. I the difference between the two movies, I mean, they basically both had the same script. The same story. This one had a little bit more of a hopeful ending. This one,
I like
also,
the hopeful ending.
This one also had the more glossy Hollywood glitz to it. You had the great ad-libbing from Hank Azaria, from Robin Williams, from Nathan Lane, who just took these roles and just made them their own. Absolutely love this movie. And also I realized, I didn't even think of this. Wasn't the Matthew Shepard incident around this time? So that's
what incident is that? Yeah. The boy who got beaten.
The boy, yeah, I think it was like in Wyoming or something.
Yes,
I think that was around this time too. So yeah, like Vicky says, it humanizes a portion of the population that has been and still is to a degree treated really unfairly and really badly. Over something that A, they have no control over, and B, they're just trying to live their lives. Yeah. Let's leave people
besides
alone.
Besides gay people, like, you know, it's like, even though Keith picks on me and stuff, I still love him as a friend because women are all bitches. I love my gay male friends more than anybody else.
And all women are my bitches.
Right.
But yeah, I love
Keith's the next podcast, Keith's Bitches.
That's our new spinoff.
Yeah. Oh my god, that would be funny actually. We could be like The View. Yeah.
Hello, this is Kishago, and this is Kishago Bitches. And today we have
Joy Behar.
But yeah, I absolutely love the idea. I love the idealistic view of this, that if only we can get these people to meet people in the gay community and see that there's nothing wrong with these people. They're just trying to live their lives as they see.
I think for the most part, they're okay. I think when you get some of the militant stuff going on, I think that shuts people's attitudes
But
down.
I think in the case of communities where people have been marginalized, I think you need the militant people to kind of force things through, because otherwise, what are you going to be left with? You're just going to be left with hoping that everybody. There was an episode of The Simpsons where John Waters.
What were they predicting this time?
Well, it was John Waters around this time playing a gay man that Homer likes initially until he finds out he's gay.
He's gay.
Then Homer hates him for a while, and then at the end, the John Waters character comes back and saves his life, and that's what makes Homer realize, oh, you know, you're not that bad. I'm like,
like when Archie Bunker finds out his best friend from the service is gay. Have you ever seen that episode?
Yeah,
oh my
there's
gosh.
That too.
That, gold. It's gold.
I think we need a little bit of the militant push in some communities to kind of be like, no, listen.
Within reason. It bothers me when people get somewhere and then they send in the militia and the militia puts them back a few decades because they're so militant that it's got the message has been lost is what I'm thinking.
I think we can agree that, okay, first of all, you're never going to be able to eradicate stupid people anyway.
Right.
But you can make the stupid people less. And I got a feeling, you know, in this day and age, I think we're doing quite well.
I think we are too. I think we're doing all right. We're getting there.
And
nothing's ever perfect, but we're getting there.
Well,
like I said, progress is slow.
The human race is never going to be perfect anyway.
Yeah, we're a vile species.
But if we look at the last 20 years, we're doing better than we're doing.
Right.
Doesn't necessarily mean we need to stop. Doesn't mean we need to stop. But I just
think Mother Earth will dispatch us eventually. Eventually.
Seems like it's fucking trying.
Right. Well, it is down here. It's 104 degrees, so we're getting dispatched down here. That's for sure.
But yeah, ultimately the message I see in this movie is let people be, man. Just let people live their lives.
I would love in-laws like that. If I had in-laws like that, I'd be over there every freaking holiday. That was the way they lived.
But Vicky, you are queen of the fag hag, so that's a bit of difference.
Oh, yeah. Fuck off, dude.
Yeah. But yeah, that's basically my thing. I love the message of this movie. I absolutely adore this movie. It's so much fun because
it just is.
Just the sheer charisma of the actors that you have in this just makes the movie. It's half an hour longer than the original, and you don't even feel it.
Because of the Guatemalan-ness. I might ever get over him doing that. And the clothes he had on, you know, like the little lacy things. And then he's got her.
When he's wearing the thong and dancing by the pool.
Yes.
while Robin Williams is talking to his son, it's fantastic.
Oh my god, it's awesome. It's a great
didn't movie. Hank Azeez, he used to do the voice of Apu and
Simpsons. Yes, he was the voice of Apu on The Simpsons for a while, until
I didn't know that.
A few years ago.
Yeah.
Well, he did a lot of voices on The Simpsons. If you look at his IMDb, you'll see he did a lot. I think he did Chief Wiggum too.
Yeah,
I think there were a few of them.
Yeah, he got his big break. I mean, he was around before that, but his main work was The Simpsons.
I mean, you see him in other stuff. Like he's the guy that Al Pacino's wife is cheating on Al with in Heat. I forget the character's name. He's the guy that the wife is fucking around with. Like you see him pop up and stuff.
Godzilla, like Matthew Broderick's Godzilla.
Oh my god, I love it when he almost steps on him and then he realizes he's still alive and he's like,
I mean,
I love him. I just love him.
But he did one of the greatest TV shows on TV, which I used to love, called Huff. He had the young actor who got run over by his own car, Yeltsin.
Oh, Anton Yeltsin. Oh, okay.
He played a sports announcer too on a series, and I couldn't stop laughing. He was a real drunk too. I mean, oh my god, what was the name of that? It's so funny.
Oh, Herman. That I don't know. I remember I liked him on Herman's Head, like in the early '90s. But I was a really young kid at that point.
He's been around for a long time, actually.
Yeah, he's been at this for at least 30 years. So at least 30 years that he's been a successful actor. Who knows how long before that?
Oh god, what is the name of that show? But it's on one of the. Oh my god, it's so good. He's so funny.
He never became like a huge star, but he's always working.
I love him.
I would sit there and say that if I wasn't. Actor, I think the best kind of actor would be a character actor because we work forever.
Yeah, this is true. We've always say this about every, especially when we get into the old movies like the Alfred Hitchcock movies and stuff. Character actors are so important to any project.
Or you just got to be like Tom Cruise and just be fucking gorgeous until the day you die.
I know. I'm beginning to wonder if he's a freaking vampire or something. The man doesn't age.
I was listening to Mark Kermode and Simon Mayo, they were on the BBC and now they have a podcast and they were interviewing Miles Teller. And one of the first things that they joked about was when the new Top Gun comes out, it's going to make 60-year-old men feel like all kinds of ways. Cause the average 60-year-old man is not going to look like Tom Cruise at 60. And I think he just turned
maybe there's
like
something to Scientology, guys. You know, maybe we're just in the wrong business.
I think there's probably something to do with like the plastic surgery.
A little bit.
Botox. A bit of Botox. A little bit.
And having so much money that you never have to worry about anything.
Stress. A worry-free life. What can you guys even imagine what a worry-free life is? I can't. No. So.
Well, I mean, I have to sit there and say there's a difference between Tom Cruise and Top Gun 2 and Tom Cruise when he shows up on the red carpet. There's two different faces going on. So there might be a little bit of trickery going on there with the
camera. I mean,
he still looks great, though.
He looks fantastic at 60. He looks better at 60 than I do at 40.
Yeah.
So,
think on me and Keith feel.
I'm 3 years younger than him, so I can't say anything.
Oh yeah, you're 2 weeks younger than me, you asshole.
I'm saying I'm 3 years younger than Tom Cruise. I'm only 3 years behind him.
Is he 60?
He's 60 now. Yeah,
he's 60. I thought he was still in his latter 50s.
And he's from Rochester, New York. Who would have thought?
Yeah.
So
Rochester, good old.
And he went to Syracuse. And he went to Syracuse University.
Yep.
So.
He had money back then because the tuition, when I got accepted, I never went because I couldn't afford it. But it was like $20,000 back then, a semester. It was ridiculous. So I went to another college. But
oof, that's insane.
It was insane then. Can you imagine now?
I can't imagine what it is now then.
Oh, God, no. It was expensive.
So this brings us to the end of the Literary License Podcast. Our next Make Remake will be King Kong, the original, and King Kong, the Peter Jackson version. I would suggest if you're going to see King Kong, get the Blu-ray version of it, because Peter Jackson recreates the cut scenes for it.
Oh, he put the
original King Kong. The original King Kong has some cut scenes that they couldn't.
Rating or for time?
It has to do with the simple fact that it didn't look right because couldn't get the stop motion part of it right. Peter Jackson went in with the original script and filmed it the same exact way that they did from the 1930s King Kong and put it back into the King Kong movie. So you wouldn't even know. So it's basically King Kong fighting the lizard and the snake thing. And they have it in the new the Peter Jackson version. Peter Jackson's pretty much a shot-by-shot almost remake of it with some added flair. So it's quite interesting. So if you do see the King Kong, try to see the other Blu-ray because it's quite interesting to see.
You're talking about the 33 one? See it on Blu-ray?
Yeah.
I still have the tin.
It's on the tin one. I got the tin one.
Yeah, mine was DVD though, so I don't know if it is it on that?
It should be on that.
I'll check when we go.
Give it a check because it's quite an interesting little documentary about the making of King Kong. It's probably one of the best documentaries. Yeah, I think it might be on the DVD as well because mine's in the tin as well. So they probably came out with the same back of them both. So
yeah, I didn't have Blu-ray back when that came out. So yeah, all right, I'll check it out.
And okay, so that will be our make remake. Our next episode for the 80s will be Society and Parents. Wondering about how the rich suck off the poor and basically about cannibalism in 1950s America.
Yeah.
And of course, we'll continue with Dark Shadows. Our book to screen for next month will be The Rats with James Herbert and the unfortunate film that they made of that called Deadly Eyes. And we'll be covering that. So
I didn't realize that was a novel. Oh my God. Deadly Eyes.
I didn't either. I didn't either.
Deadly Eyes is terrible.
Interestingly enough, The Rats by James Herbert sold over 20 million copies. The book did.
Have fun with that one.
Yeah, the book's great. The book's great, though. It's James Herbert, so you can't go wrong. Who also wrote The Fog? So it's good night for myself. Good night, Joe.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, Vicky.
Tell me your story. I'll tell you mine. I'm all ears. Take your time. We got all night. Show me the rivers cross the mountain scale. Show me who made you walk all the way here. Settle down. Put your bags down. You're ready. We'll turn the page together.
bottle. It's time we celebrate who you were, who you are. We're one and the same, yeah, yeah. We don't need to be related to relate. We don't need to share genes or a surname. You are my chosen, chosen family. So what if we don't look the same? We've been going through the same thing, yeah. You are my chosen, chosen family.
I chose you. Or a surname, you are my chosen.